Well, we're so grateful to come here together and to celebrate this Feast of the Three Higher Arts with all of you, and to kind of gain some insights into what the church has to say about 21st century orthodoxy. What does it mean to be a 21st century Orthodox Christian? And they have a great deal to say about all of that. With that, we have Allison, who is going to come up and offer an introduction of our speaker. If you would, please, Allison, come on up.
Welcome, everybody. Archpriest Father Basil has quite a wonderful, varied background. He appreciates and cooks fine foods and pursues music and poetry, especially that of his native Scotsman nationality. Perhaps that's part of the richness he drew from when he became a parish priest at St. Nicholas Orthodox Church after graduating from St. Vladimir's Orthodox Seminary. He's especially good at connecting the dots between orthodoxy and the good things of God's earth in these times that we live in. He's also the dean of the Orthodox Church in America. We are beyond blessed to have him here with us today.
Thank you. Anyway, today we're at the title I was given, The Three Doctors' Cure for the 21st Century Epidemic. So first, my mind thinking about doctors. Second thing I did was... Any doctors in... Doctors kind of make me nervous. I go only when I'm forced to go. And I'm usually only forced to go by my dear wife, known to you as Matushka or Presbytera, Joni. But to me, she is and will always be she who must be obeyed.
Me.
Now, don't get me wrong, I love my doctor, I really do. But sometimes she pushes my buttons in order to get me to do things that I know that I already should be doing, and to stop doing the things that I already know that I should stop doing. For instance, recently, we were talking about my weight. It's a constant battle for me. Well, anyway, she took one look at my boiler. Can you believe it? She refused to believe that I work out. No, she didn't believe me. So I listed all the exercises I do every day. I jump to conclusions. I climb the walls. I drag my heels. I push my luck. I make mountains out of molehills. I bend over backward. I run and round in circles. I put my foot in my mouth. Try that. And I frequently go over the top. But seriously, today we're talking about doctors, but we're talking about doctors of a very different sort. The three great doctors of the Orthodox Church, those, quotes, three apostles added to the 12, as the service calls them. Basil the Great, Gregory the Theologian, and John Chrysostom, the three holy hierarchs whom we celebrate this day. So now we have to ask ourselves, how do these doctors heal us? What cures are they offering? And what is the 21st century epidemic, anyway? Well, first of all, we must ask, why three doctors? What is a doctor of the church? Maybe we've heard that title before. Probably most of us haven't. It may sound strange to our ears because it's really a Western usage, doctor of the church. And it really wasn't even a Western usage until the 16th century, it seems. But the word doctor is simply Latin for what? Who knows? Anybody? From the Latin do, docere, to teach. Yeah. Teacher. It means teacher. So when Western Christians refer to a doctor of the church, they mean those church fathers or mothers who are the most exceptional, the most lofty teachers of the faith, of doctrine, and of the ways of salvation. That's why in the Lord I Have Cried verses at Vespers for the three hierarchs, we sang, let us who follow their teachings praise the instruments of the Holy Spirit with hymns. They are the trumpets of truth, the words of lofty oration. Let us entreat them, for they are bold before the Lord, that he may always grant forgiveness to us all and grant peace to the whole world. And later on in the same service, we heard this, with what beautiful hymns shall we crown the God-bearing initiates of heaven, preachers of the mysteries, leading theologians of the Orthodox faith, Basil, manifest in holiness, Gregory, godly and divinely inspired, John of the golden tongue, whom the Trinity has fittingly glorified. Now, in the Orthodox Church, we don't really have any official title that might be equivalent to what the Westerns call Doctor of the Church. We have titles, different kinds of titles. We have, like, the Great, as in Basil the Great. We have Theologian, although we only have three of those. St. John the Apostle and Evangelist, St. Gregory the Theologian, whom we're commemorating this day, and St. Simeon the New Theologian. Are there any others? I could only think of those three. I think that's it, right?
That's it.
Yeah. In the Orthodox Church, we have some saints who are distinguished from others by a title which says something about them. For instance, St. John Chrysostom. We know it means the one with the golden mouth. You know, there's kind of pious story behind this. Do you know? You know, how did he get that title? Who came up with that? Did you ever hear the kind of pious folk tale regarding how St. John Chrysostom got this title in the first place? Well, it goes something like this. When he was preaching in Antioch, when he was newly ordained, you know, and he would preach long and lofty sermons, and one day after the liturgy was concluding, people were coming up to take the antiphon. One little old lady came up and said, Father John, you just have a golden mouth. And he said, oh, thank you, my dear. She said, it's just a shame I don't understand a word you say. And it said that after that, he tailored his preaching less toward rhetoricians and more toward the common people and their spiritual growth, which is why his sermons were preserved for all these centuries. Because when we read them, even if we read them in some kind of lofty 19th century translation, nonetheless, we feel like he's really just talking to us. And his words are right for, they come right for me. In the Orthodox Church, we certainly look to these three champions of the faith to be our healers, don't we? We look to them to be our helpers. We look to them to give us something which will make us whole. In fact, we celebrate all three of them together today, even though they have their individual feasts beforehand. It's all culminated in this one great feast, all three of them today, so that the grace bestowed upon us will be three times stronger. Now today, I'm not really going to talk about their lives. I'm not going to talk about their icon. I'm not going to talk about how this feast day came to be. You all know that, don't you? Who all knows that already? Oh my goodness, maybe I should have talked about it. Oh well, it'll be for another time. read about it. But I do want to talk about how they heal us and how they, by the grace of God, can heal the whole world. When Father Allen asked me to speak on the topic of the three doctors' cure for the 21st century epidemic, I had no idea what he meant by it.
Neither did I.
Okay, all right, all right. I was really tempted to call him and say, well, what are you really going for here? Well, you must be thinking of something, but, you know, I thought instead, I'll just pray about it. I'll just, you know, I'll let God, you know, speak to me, give me something. So, here we go. Now, first off, I'm going to warn you, I'm going to read a long citation. I apologize. It's a long citation. So what does that mean for you? It means that you really have to put on your listening ears. You have to make the sign of the cross. You have to say, dear God, snatch my brain away from distraction. Right? St. Seraphim of Sarov says, say the Jesus prayer, snap your mind right back. Focus. Because the words are not my words. It's the words of St. John Chrysostom. Okay? The words of St. John Chrysostom in his 16th homily, I'm not reading the whole thing. His 16th homily on Genesis, okay? He's discussing Adam and Eve and the temptation brought by the serpent. So here we go. I tried to clean up the language a little bit. I don't mean he's swearing. But you know what I mean. It's this 19th century academic language. That's, you know, you need a snow plow to get through. I tried to make it, but you will still hear. So just try to really. St. John Chrysostom says, blessed Moses, remember, told us that Adam and Eve were naked without feeling shame. After all, they didn't even know that they were naked because they were clothed in ineffable glory, which adorned them better than any clothes. Moses then tells us that, quote, the serpent was the wiliest of all the beasts upon the earth made by the Lord. The serpent said to the woman, why is it that God said, do not eat of any tree of the garden? Genesis 3:1, Septuagint. You know what I mean, Septuagint? Ah, more of you know that. Good. Continuing. See the evil spirit's jealousy. See his devious scheming. I mean, he saw that the human being, creature though he was, had the good fortune to enjoy the highest place in God's esteem and was scarcely inferior in any respect to the angels. As blessed David also says, you have placed him only a little lower than the angels. And even this little lower than the angels was simply as a result of disobedience. The inspired author, after all, uttering this after the fall. The author of evil, accordingly, seeing another angel living on his earth, to which he'd been cast down, was consumed with envy. Zelia, Zelia. Since he himself had once enjoyed a place among the powers above, but had been cast down from that pinnacle on account of his depravity of will and excess of wickedness. So, he employed considerable skill so as to pluck the human being from God's favor, render him ungrateful, and divest him of all those benefits provided for him through God's loving kindness. So how did he do it? He discovered this wild animal, namely the serpent. superior to all the other animals by his cunning, as blessed Moses testified in the words, "The serpent was the wiliest of all the beasts on the earth made by the Lord God." He made use of this creature like some instrument, and through it tricked the naive woman into deception by means of a conversation. The serpent spoke to the woman, the text says. Consider from this, dearly beloved, how in the beginning none of the wild animals that existed then caused fear either to Adam or to Eve. On the contrary, they recognized human guidance and lordship. And as with tame animals these days, in those days even the ones we would consider wild and savage were subdued as if they were tame. Now today, some troublemaker, Chrysostom used a different word, but I like that one better. Today, some troublemaker might like to infer that serpents in paradise maybe were able to speak. No, absolutely not. If we read the scriptures carefully, we'll understand that the words came from the devil, not from the serpent, who was spurred on to this deception by his own ill will, while this wild animal he merely used like some convenient instrument, so as to be able to set the bait for his deception, and thus upset the woman first of all, and then through her, Adam, the first formed man. So he employs this irrational animal for laying out his plan, and by means of it, he speaks to the woman in these words. Why is it that God said, "Do not eat of any tree of the garden"? Notice the extreme subtlety of the malice. Notice how, in the unfolding of his plan, he introduces words not spoken by God at all. Notice, too, how he acts as though he's only motivated by care for Adam and Eve. This, in fact, is what emerges from his words. Why is it that God said, "Do not eat of any tree in the garden"? It's as if the evil demon were saying, "Why did he deprive you of such enjoyment? Why doesn't he allow you to share in the good things of the garden? Why does he allow you only the pleasure of looking at them while not permitting you to own them and thus gain even greater enjoyment? Why is it that God said?" In other words, what is God's reason? What is God's reason for saying this to you? How can your life be good in the garden if you aren't free to enjoy all the things in it? In fact, you are actually worse off because you are suffering because you can see the trees, but you can't eat their fruit. You still with me? Everybody awake? This is still Chrysostom, but it's pretty good, isn't it?
Yes.
Huh? Okay. "Do you see," says St. John, "how he uses his words like bait to inject his poison?" The woman should have been able to tell even from his first approach, his extreme agitation and the fact that he deliberately said what was untrue and made a pretense of care for them as a part of his plan, so as to be in a position to find out the instructions they actually had been given by God, and thus lead them to their downfall. Of course, he didn't want her to be able to recognize his trickery and break off her conversation with him as being useless talk, and so avoid being dragged down to a low level. After all, there was no need for her to get involved in a conversation with him in the first place. Parenthetical aside, how many of us have gotten ourselves involved in a conversation we wish we had never entered into? Instead, if she needed to have a conversation, she should have done it with the one with whom she shared everything on equal terms, and whose helpmate she had been made. But acting impetuously, how I do not know, St. John says, she got involved in this conversation with the serpent. And through him, as through an instrument, she took in the devil's deadly words. So it ensued that she learnt from the devil's speech the very opposite of what God actually said. Whereas the Creator gave one set of directions, the devil gave the opposite. He did very well. That's the end of St. John's quote. His homilies on Genesis are wonderful, if you ever have the opportunity to read them. So, now again, I'm sorry for that gigantic passage, but it illustrates so clearly to me what, at least to my mind, is the 21st century epidemic. But in truth, it's the perennial epidemic. From the time of the garden, it is the epidemic. Originally, I thought the epidemic, I might talk about secularism, but I'm sick of hearing about secularism. Because secularism is just a result, it's just a symptom. A huge problem, but just a symptom. And then along the way, I thought, well, you know, maybe I'll go a really radically different direction. And I would talk about the 21st century epidemic as being loneliness. Loneliness. Why loneliness? Well, last November I read an article that was written by a Michel Audouard, a well-respected British speaker, writer, trainer in the area of stress management and mental illness. The article was entitled, Loneliness, A Spiritual Approach to a 21st Century Epidemic. I didn't come up with it on my own. It's a great article, a little bit New Agey, in fact a lot New Agey. But the topic is a fascinating one and could easily serve as a future subject for a talk by someone. Loneliness, it's big. But no, loneliness is also simply a symptom. For me, the ultimate epidemic for the 21st century, as I said, is the same epidemic that began there in the Garden of Eden with a conversation, and that is lies. Lies. Not too long ago, Joni and I were on a little vacation in Victoria, British Columbia. How many of you have been there? Oh, I love it. I just love that place. We were really tired of walking up and down Government Street and decided to hire one of those bicycle rickshaw guys to pedal us around and give us a little tour. It's a beautiful city. There's lots to see. It also has a very small but very old and interesting Chinatown. Second oldest, I think, in North America, after San Francisco. At the entrance to it, there is an ornate and beautiful Chinese gate that's called the Gate of Harmonious Interest. Well, that means I have no idea. Perhaps it has something to do with banking. But on each side of the gate, there is a beautiful carved stone lion on each side. As we pedaled past these lions, our guide, the guy on the bike, who could still talk while pedaling, I was admiring that right away. He says there's a contemporary legend that says that on the day that an honest politician passes through this gate, the lions will roar. It's safe to say that in Victoria, no roaring has yet occurred. Dear ones, the three holy hierarchs, they teach us many, many things. Impossible to enumerate all of them. They teach us about suffering and persecution. They teach us about love and care for the poor. They teach us about courage. They teach us about love for God, the benefits of the ascetical life, the value of monasticism. I could go on and on. But perhaps the most important lesson that they've left for us is the value of truth. To them, in many ways, we owe our right belief. To them, in many ways, we owe our orthodoxy, which means the right faith, the right belief. It also means the right worship. But our correct understanding of God, and our correct understanding of the Holy Trinity, and our correct understanding of the Incarnation. Cor Deus Homo, why did God become man? In the first Kantakion of the Akathist hymn to St. Basil the Great, we hear words which could equally apply to all three of these wonderful bishops commemorated today. It goes like this: O chosen minister of the King of Heaven, and great hierarch of the Church of Christ, who didst shine forth throughout the whole world in the confession of the right faith, and art possessed of great boldness before the Holy Trinity. From all misfortunes, shield us who cry out to thee with compunction. Rejoice, O Basil, great and holy hierarch, universal lamp of orthodoxy. End of the quote. He shines forth, St. Basil, throughout the whole world because of his preaching and his defense of the right faith. Now, I'd like to pay special attention to the words right faith, orthodoxy, right faith. They have produced deadly fruit. The doctrines of true religion are overthrown. The laws of the church are in confusion. The ambition of men who have no fear of God rushes into high posts and exalted office, and is now publicly known as the prize of impiety. The result is that the worse a man blasphemes, the fitter that people think him to be. All the while unbelievers laugh, men of weak faith are shaken. Faith is uncertain. Souls are drenched in ignorance because adulterators of the word imitate the truth. The mouths of true believers are dumb, while every blasphemous tongue wags free. St. Basil's letter to the Italians and Gauls, letter 92. Good stuff. Even a little bit of admixture, I don't even know if that's a word, of truth and lies produces a great disaster for our souls. Do you remember the Lord's conversation? There's a safe conversation there. Remember the Lord's conversation with the woman at the well? Saint Fotini, Saint Svetlana. The religion of the Samaritans was about 90% the same as the Jews. And when she, a Samaritan, asked Jesus about whose religion was true, or beneath the surface was also sort of asking, are they both okay? What did the Lord say? The Lord said in John chapter 4, says to the woman, you worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Wow, hard words. She's looking for kind of bridge building. And he says, what? The unthinkable. You're wrong. You guys are wrong. God spoke to the Jews. This is the revelation. This is what the truth is. If you deviate from that, you deviate from what God gave and what God revealed to the world. He says you're not even worshiping the same God. Have you heard about the controversy going on at Wheaton College? Anybody heard? Nobody? Okay, a couple of you. All right. Wheaton College. A tenured Wheaton College political science professor began to wear a hijab during Advent last year in support of her Muslim friends and neighbors. She was placed on administrative leave, not for donning her Islamic head covering, but over, quotes, significant questions regarding the theological implications of her explanation about why she was wearing the headscarf. So how did she explain it? Her name is Larissa Alain Hawkins. That's her name. And she's the professor. She announced that she would don the traditional hijab as a sign of human, theological, and embodied solidarity. This is what she wrote in Facebook. I stand in religious solidarity with Muslims because they, like me, a Christian, are people of the book. The Muslims call us the people of the book. Like me, a Christian, are people of the book. And as Pope Francis stated last week, we all worship the same God. That's the end of her little Facebook quote. So it sounds very different from what the Lord said. Truth matters. Truth matters. She could have said, I stand in solidarity with my Muslim friends and my neighbors by wearing a headscarf, which we Christians, of course, had long before they had it, and they learned it from us. Or put a nicer way, somehow. She could have said that. I'm standing in solidarity because they're being persecuted. I'm showing a sign somehow. Traditional Christianity also wears this headscarf. But no, she said we all worship the same God. So, truth matters. Unadulterated, pure, whole truth is not only important, but it's vital to our salvation. That's what the Lord says, not Father Basil. What the Lord says. What else did the Lord say? The Lord said, I am the truth. I am the truth. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. John 14, 6. Now, I'm not going to get into who will be saved at the end of time, the second coming. That's all for God to decide, and that's not what I'm talking about here. But I will say this, to those who pervert the truth, and especially to those who pervert the truth about God intentionally, that they will not inherit the kingdom of God. Absolutely not. Why? Because only the truth can set you free. What we believe about God, what we believe about Christ, what we say to others about our faith, it's all critically important. It's important that we get it right. Which is why it's the obligation of us all to be well-versed in our faith, to know our scriptures. You know, the Lord wants us to immerse ourselves daily in the scriptures. It's part of the daily life of an Orthodox Christian. St. Jerome once said, if we don't know the scriptures, we don't know the Lord. Okay? That's why the three holy hierarchs were so willing to suffer so much, and they did, at the hands of those who fought against the truth. They defended the truth about who Jesus is against the lies of the Arians. They defended the divinity of the Holy Spirit against the pneumatomachi. That is those who, it means literally the fighters against the Spirit. Those who believe that God is a duality instead of a trinity. Only the Father and the Son are God. The Holy Spirit is a force or an energy or the power of love uniting the Father and the Son, but not God according to them. By the way, St. Augustine comes dangerously close to this. He tiptoes. The three holy hierarchs also defended the truth of the church's moral teachings. Yeah. St. Basil writes lots about morals. Lots. And they rail against those who would corrupt them. This was especially true concerning every Christian's moral obligation toward the poor. There was no excuse for withholding charity. Chrysostom, of course, we know is the champion of this. Every homily of Chrysostom always ends up with, you have to give to the poor. He always manages to get around to it. St. Basil issued a whole series of moral maxims and sermons. Why are morals so important in the discussion of truth? Because truth cannot be discerned except in the context of a pure and moral life. Period. In other words, you can't know the truth unless you're actively living, seeking a moral life. St. Basil says, how earnestly, he says this about reading the Bible. St. Basil says, how earnestly the soul should prepare itself to receive such high lessons. How pure it should be from carnal affections. How unclouded by worldly disquietudes. How active and ardent in its researches. How eager to find in its surroundings an idea of God which may be worthy. I'm very nearly done. But we'll have time to talk about this and discuss among ourselves and answer some questions. But what? I guess I'm not that nearly done. Well, I'm getting, I can see the, brothers and sisters, I see the light at the end of the tunnel. I want to remind you about a few points about lies. Because I think our whole downfall, the whole downfall of our civilization, of our morals, of our politics, everything has to do with that. That's why I saw it as the 21st century epidemic. Lies everywhere, lies. affairs of Gaza. He says, I'd like to remind you, dear brethren, about lies, for I can see that you do not take special care to control your tongue. And so we are easily led into making mistakes. For you see, my brethren, that for everything, as I always say to you, habit plays a role both in terms of the good and the bad. Great caution and vigilant attention are therefore needed, so that we are not fooled by lies. Attention to our moral life, our spiritual life, gives us the key to discerning between truth and falsehood. All the fathers say this. Since no one, says St. Dorotheus, no one who tells lies has been united to God, lying has absolutely nothing to do with him, for it is written that lies come from the evil one. And elsewhere it is written, the devil is a liar and the father of lies. See, it says that the devil is the father of lies. God, however, is truth. He himself says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. You can then understand from whom we are separated and to whom we are joined when we lie. It is abundantly clear that we are joined to the devil. If we truly want to be saved, we have an obligation to take every care to love the truth with all of our strength and to guard ourselves from every kind of falsehood so that it does not separate us from truth and therefore from life. There are, he says, three different ways for one to tell lies. I could probably come up with a few more, but he comes up with three. One way is to tell lies with the mind. This is why he did such a thing. This is a person who tells lies with his mind. He doesn't say anything, that is true, but he bases everything on suspicion. Thus, curiosity, slander, eavesdropping, fighting, and condemnation arise in his soul. Sometimes happens that someone suspects something which in the end turns out to be true. But he gives himself an excuse about the other times, saying that being suspicious allows him an opportunity to be right sometimes and to correct himself at other times when he's wrong. First of all, this bias which he allows in his soul is a work of the evil one, because it commenced with a lie. That is to say, without knowing, he suspected what he did not know. How then can a bad tree produce good fruit? Yet if he wants to be corrected, he should not become upset when his brother tells him, do not do that, or why did you do this, but rather humble himself and thank him, and then he will be corrected. If God sees that this is his intention, he will never allow him to go astray and will send him the appropriate person in order to be corrected. However, to say, since I want to be corrected, I will believe my suspicions and consequently I will continue to eavesdrop and to be curious, is a thought which the devil creates and develops in an attempt, what, to destroy him. Once, Dorotheus writes, when I was in a monastery, I had the temptation of wanting to deduce someone's internal state by watching his movements. Something then happened. Where I was standing, a woman passed by holding a jug of water. I do not know how I was carried away, but I watched her eyes. Immediately the thought came to me, as soon as I thought this, I became very worried, mentioned it to my spiritual father, Abba John, saying, Father, if without wanting to I see someone and conclude in my mind the spiritual condition of that person, what should I do? The spiritual father answered in the following way, is it not true that often a natural injury or disability cannot be overcome without a lot of hard work and effort? You cannot deduce anyone's condition from suspicion. Never believe what you suspect about anyone. Suspicions are false, and they only cause harm. From then onwards, even if my thoughts were that the sun is the sun, or that darkness is darkness, I wouldn't believe them. There's nothing more intense than suspicions. They are so very harmful because they remain within us for such a long time, and they begin to convince us that we see clearly things that have never occurred, neither do they exist. Let us avoid falsehood, brethren, so as to be delivered from the evil one. Let us struggle like the three great holy hierarchs to obtain always and only the truth, so that we may be united with him who said, "I am the truth." Let God make us worthy of his truth. Amen.
The only thing is, say it loudly. Your question, say it loudly so the camera can
pick it up. So that it'll pick it up, yeah.
I'm a guest of the church, and I was noticing beautiful ornamentation artistry, and it was pointed out by a friend that one of the members of the disciples above you is Judas. And my question is, based on
the scary
sermon, why did he feel compelled to accept a bribe and have Jesus crucified? What was the reasoning he had that it was justifiable to murder somebody?
Two questions. First of all, we have no icons of Judas, unless it's in the historical context, like at the Last Supper. You have the other Judas, or commonly known as Jude, after whom a hospital is named. That does very good work. That's the Apostle Jude, but they're both, it's the same name, Judas. But
the icon right over your head is the Last Supper.
So that's the Last Supper, right?
You see Judas without the head. His head sideways.
Yeah, he's down there without the head.
Right.
So that's the first part. And the second part is, Judas is a perfect example, Judas Iscariot. He was being taught from the mouth of God, but he listened to the voice of a different conversation. Yeah. We talk in Orthodox spiritual terms of what we call the logismi. That's a Greek word. I don't know what the Russian, but the logismi. And the logismi, it's plural, from logismos. It means the thought, a thought. St. Paul refers to these kind of thoughts that come from outside of us, meaning from our spiritual enemies. He refers to them, I think it's, well, I'm not going to say, but I might be wrong, and I'm on tape. He calls them the fiery darts of the evil one. And these are thoughts that come to us, boom, when we're standing in church and suddenly the most unbelievably horrible thought comes to our mind. Or, boom, an arrow of a thought comes into our mind about, did I leave something on the stove at home? Right? Or some kind of a thought that tempts our thinking so that we entertain it, some theological thought, some thought about doubting God, or doubting the incarnation, or doubting Jesus' resurrection. Haven't we all had that experience? And it comes out like out of nowhere. And that's the logismi. And Judas, who by his own nature and temperament was not entirely in sync with the rest of the disciples and with Jesus, he was much more subject to those logismi, and eventually those same logismi encouraged him to commit suicide. It's the ultimate outcome desired by the devil for our life. And how do we know that? Suicide. Because how many times during the course of the church year do we read the same gospel over and over and over again about what? The piggies. pagans. I have priest friends, I have lay friends. They complain, Father, why are we having to hear again about the demons going into the piggies and jumping over the cliff and drowning?
Swine flu.
Yeah, the swine flu, that's right. Why? Yeah, and they actually say, why? Let's replace it with something. Let's get the, we have like four times in the course of the year. But I think the Holy Fathers knew exactly what they were doing. It's because what happened with the pigs is what the devil wants to happen to us. So Judas listened to the wrong voice, just like the woman in the garden. Does that answer your question? Okay, thanks.
You mentioned one of the lies. You said lies of the mind, words, and our entire life.
Yeah.
What did you mean by lies?
Yeah, I didn't develop that, did I? I kind of talked about the first one, but I didn't sort of go into the second and the third one. I had meant to, but I was too tired and it was already last night. Allison had asked me, I don't know, a week ago, Father, can you give me kind of a little idea about what you're talking to me about? I said, no. Oh, and why not? Because I have no idea. And I didn't. So lies of the mind, lies of the words, and lies of the entire life. I think if we just take a minute to think about it, it's pretty clear. Sometimes the lies just run around in our heads. Sometimes we act on those things, sometimes we don't. I think mental illness, people with mental illness have lots of trouble in this area because they can't distinguish sometimes, and depending on the illness, what's their own thoughts and what's the demonic thoughts. Well, in fact, it's not just mentally ill, it's all of us we have trouble discerning. What's our thought? What's a thought that's being shot into us, into our mind by the devil? Or what's just, you know, maybe a thought coming from God? That's not so frequent, but it does occur. And that's where that holiness of life comes in order to discern what is the false thought, what is the lie coming into the mind, or what is the truth coming into the mind. So that's, you know, lies of the mind. Lies of the words, that's when we take the lie that first comes into the mind and we actually express it. It's like Arius, you know, St. Basil's great enemy, along with the other Cappadocian fathers. Arius, who a theological thought came to into his mind about Jesus Christ, and how, you know, he just couldn't accept the teaching of the church and even the teaching of the scripture. His mind wanted to read it differently. His mind was filled with thoughts about, you know, this can't be, God is not a human being. Okay? And I'm making it more simple than it really is. But so what does he do? Instead of just thinking the thought and going to confession and saying, Father, you know, I'm having these kind of wrong theological thoughts, you know, forgive me and pray for me. Instead, he starts preaching them. So that's lies with words. Or on a more personal level, when we decide that, oh, we can keep ourselves from getting into trouble with someone or getting into trouble with the authorities, and so we decide to tell a lie. So it first comes into the mind, then it comes out of the mouth. Lying with our whole life, it can mean a lot of things. You know, we can put on a whole persona that's just false. We project one image about who we are, but in reality we're entirely somebody else. And you know that, you probably heard this, that in the holy canons, actors are not permitted to become catechumens and are not to be baptized into the church. Did you ever hear that?
No.
Well, we don't enforce that rule anymore. Because the profession of acting and actors has become somewhat different today. A lot of times in ancient times, the plays that were being offered were pagan plays. And sometimes it involved nudity and it involved sex. It's like movies today. Lots of sex and lots of, yeah, lewdness, nudity, foul speaking, and all of that. And so they said actors cannot enter into the catechumenate to become Christians until they leave off that profession. But you know, in the Gospels, Jesus, he's always railing against one particular group of people. Well, he rails against the scribes, he rails against the Pharisees, and he also rails against the... Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees! Hypocrites! You know what hypocrites means in Greek? Actors! Yeah! Because they put a mask over their face and they pretend that they're someone else. It's false. It's a lie. It's projecting a lie. He, of course, is using it in the sense of posers, phonies. You pretend to be religious, you pretend to know the law, you pretend to know God, but you don't know a thing. So not only are you ignorant, but you're telling others that they should be ignorant too. So you not only condemn yourselves by your hypocrisy, but you also cause others to stumble because of it. And that's why he calls them actors, posers. Yeah.
But aren't we all hypocrites technically in front of God? Because no one on earth is righteous except for God himself.
Yeah, sure. That's what the Christian life is all about, to try to make less of a poser and more of a real Christian out of us, right? And Chrysostom says, it's good that we recognize that we're posers. And that's what we're hoping, is that little by little, our piety, our virtue, our, you know, what we do, what we say, will become more because we simply love God, and not because we're either trying to impress somebody else or even impress ourselves or whatever. Not to become real people. That's what it is to become a Christian. To grow in the Christian life and faith is to become really who we are and not a poser, not an actor. Yeah.
I have two questions, Father.
You only get one, sorry. No. I'm kidding.
First one is, what does it mean to hear from God? And the second question is, in a situation where I pray to hear God's voice and I don't hear from Him, what should I do?
Good questions. They're related, aren't they? What is it to hear God? What does it mean to hear God? Well, of course, in the Bible, we have lots of different examples. In the lives of the saints, we have lots of different examples. In the services, the divine services, we're constantly being told to listen, to hear the voice of God and the words of God, you know, attend, let us listen, let us hear. So in the Bible we have, examples of God speaking, like from a thunder from heaven, a voice saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." We have other examples of the prophet Elijah in the cave, listening for God's word, listening for his commandment to him, and the earthquake comes, and the pillar of fire comes, and all these extreme things happening in front of his eyes, but none of those are the voice of God. And finally, it's just that still, small voice. And the fathers, they interpret that as being the still small voice of God can be heard from the conscience, which is one of the components of the heart. You know, the fathers talk about the heart as being the center of the human being. That is the temple of meeting between God and man. That's where we hope and we pray that the Jesus prayer will descend from our minds into our hearts, where clearly we have an interaction. So we can only begin to really know the voice of God. And I'm not speaking here as someone who has that ability. I think I've experienced it maybe a few times. But for the most part, we don't, because we're sinful people, we're distracted people, we're people who love to entertain ourselves, keep ourselves busy. We don't know how to be quiet. We don't know how to free ourselves from distractions. We don't know how to free ourselves from all the noise around us. And it's only by accomplishing that and living a virtuous life that we can actually, like the Father said, hear God's voice, hear it directly, hear his guidance. So what do we, living in the world and not living in a cave, do? I think it's Augustine. I could be wrong. Says, you know, basically, you know, you have a mind, you know, God gave you a mind, you know, think about it, pray about it, make the sign of the cross, and say, God, if you don't want me to do this or that, or if, you know, throw something at me, stop me. Make the best choice you can, make the sign of the cross, and say, God, stop me if this isn't the right thing. And often that's the only way we can really operate. But does that answer any of your question or questions?
Somewhat, yes.
Okay. What didn't? What didn't I get?
My guess is there's no definite answer to any of those questions.
You know, the other thing I do is, if I really want to discern God's will, I don't necessarily have to hear His voice. But and that's by consulting other people. Saying, I'm thinking about this, or I'm meditating on that. And I have spiritual fathers, I have Jerondis and Markella, I have all kinds of people that I can go to, that I can ask for advice. And I see in their words to me the words of God. And I just rely on that. Someone who you know is very spiritually safe and whose life is a life led in holiness and strict observance of God's commandments. Yeah, I wish it were easier. When I was a Jesus freak in the 60s, it was a lot easier. But that's because we just were pretending. I really didn't know what we were doing. So, sure, the Lord led me to buy this kind of gasoline. But, and God is not mocked. I don't mean that, you know. Yeah.
So, young people, especially, you know, college and through maybe 30s, that they're so influenced by the lies that seem to be pretty much the same in education, in entertainment,
yes,
in news. It's all kind of the same piece. That they drift away from the church because they can't reconcile some of the beliefs that they've taken on outside of the church.
Boy, no kidding.
And then so they chuck the whole church. How do you counsel young people who say, well, maybe it's gay marriage or it's some big political or
social
belief?
Yeah.
That is a very sin, it makes you a good person too. It's sort of a religious belief. And they leave the whole church because they can't reconcile that one thing with staying in the church. And they sort of just,
wow,
they go.
That happens a lot. And it more and more frequently.
I'm on Facebook now. That's how this is sort of.
Well,
I see it all.
I'm on Facebook, but I don't cruise around on it too much.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm one of those ones that say that if you put something on there and say, if you really love me, read my post and say something here and then repost it. I never do that. I never do any of that. I'm not doing that. If you ask me to do that, I may unfriend you. It's a real problem. You know, we're talking about the logis me and the thoughts. And you know, I know that we're bombarded by thoughts. All of us are bombarded by thoughts. And one time I heard Father Mel, many of you remember Father Mel, was giving a talk, and he was talking about the logis me, and he was saying, you know, sometimes we think about the fiery darts of the evil one, which I described also, which is how St. Paul described it. He says, then some people think of it more of like a stream. And he said, but the way I think about the logis me, it's more like the Mississippi River. And you are alone, standing against the flow of the Mississippi River. And how can you possibly stand against it? Only with the help of God can you. All we can do is try to be honest But always being honest in saying what is God's revealed truth, but making sure that that is laced properly, as St. Paul says, always speaking the truth with love. We don't dislike homosexual people. We don't want to make people who have these inclinations or these struggles, we do not want them to feel like we don't want them. The church is a hospital for everybody, and all of us are the patients. All of us are sick. All of us. But you see, we have to make a choice. We have to make a choice, and we have to emphasize the importance of that choice to young people. And that is, you know, do we want to embrace God's revealed truth as the truth? Or are we going to be tossed around by every wind of doctrine? I think that's St. Paul. Tossed about by every wind of doctrine, which means every new social engineering strategy that comes along, and you know, it changes all the time. There's no consistency to these social upheavals and these events. You know, what will be trendy now will not be trendy 30 years from now. It'll be something completely other. So, but we have to maintain the truth. And why is that? Because it's the truth that saves us. It's not by going along with or caving into what anybody else is saying. It doesn't matter if they're professors in prestigious universities, and it doesn't matter if they're scientists or social studies professors, or, you know, it's really bad in the schools. It's really bad in the schools. But the whole social media, the whole entertainment media, all of it is part of the great river. And people are going to get swept away. Our people are going to get swept away. They're not going to know what is God's truth and why that God's truth is important to the world and to their own salvation. Their faith is weak. Their education and orthodoxy lags far behind their education and other things. And so they get swept away. All we can do is pray, God shield them, God protect them. And if they get swept away by the waters, we pray, God pull them out. God retrieve them. God save them. It's really all we can do. But it's important for us in the churches to make sure that we're clearly teaching what's right. Because if we don't, and if we're too careful about it, and we're too, I don't know, and I'm talking to me first, you know. If we don't let people know what the truth is from right early on, then of course they're going to be swept away. They will have no hesitation. They'll just be swept away. So it's we have to take the risk. We have to be like John the Baptist, railing at Herod and Herodias, you know.
Yeah. One of the things I found helpful in dealing with the lies that come in from the culture around us is the recognition of the fact that so much of what the foundations of their beliefs are based on, you use the word lie, but I would say false premises.
Yes.
And our argument that begins with a false premise. You know, in the old days, people argued about what would happen. They thought the world was flat. They had that false premise. And they would argue about, you know, what would happen if you went out exploring and you got to the edge of the earth, and they all came up with good logical answers for that false premise.
Yes.
But it's really helpful in the context of relationship, and I want to premise all of this with that when you're having these conversations with someone, is to call to question the premise that the position that they're holding is based upon.
Yes.
You know, like, for instance, well, don't they deserve to be happy? And so I would call to question the premise that everybody deserves to be happy, number one. And I would call to question whether or not that's life's goal. And I would also call to question whether or not what they've seen in life, the pursuit of happiness, ever actually brings happiness. It doesn't. And in the context,
not in this life.
No, in the context of relationship, with someone where they trust you, those kind of questions can be discussed. And you know, you can kind of talk about, you can guide them towards premises that are based on a foundation of truth. And there is, you know, 2,000 years of evidence for that.
Very good. Yeah.
Yeah, I read a very short commentary just about what's going on with the politics right now, which is just wild. And the premise of the writer was to say that we're enthralled by people who are saying the things that we think that we'd never say, like an adolescent does. It just comes out, and it's the first thing that comes into their mind. And you know, because I couldn't figure out why folks are enthralled with some of this really outrageous behavior, you know, reality TV, and just on and on and on and on. And it is just kind of, it seems that experience, and like Father was saying, to just even draw somebody's awareness to that, of there are reasons why we don't say the first thing that comes to our mouth, you know, that we'd like to annihilate these people, or close our borders, or, you know, whatever it is, open our borders, you know, that it's not thoughtful, but that's very countercultural. It's, yeah.
Yeah, you know, politics is a hot button issue, and I try not to talk about it, except in general terms, because it really is. I mean, our whole society is kind of reeling. We kind of don't, you know, we kind of feel like a ship adrift somehow, and we're all looking to see, okay, so who's gonna lead? You know, who's gonna be our lead? But just, there is no orthodox candidate. There is no God-anointed king or queen, right? So that's just, none of that is in the offing. So we have to do our best in these situations. I think we should all vote. And I think you should vote your conscience, but vote what's in accordance with the truth, as far as you know, as far as God's revealed truth is concerned. And, you know, I know people, and I'm friends with people on complete opposite ends of the spectrum, politically. And, you know, we can argue, we can talk, we can harangue, we can... But ultimately, our focus and our center is always on the Orthodox faith, and it's always about our relationship with God. And so all of that is, okay, it's kind of a tempest in a teapot, but it doesn't really capture us, it doesn't carry us away in the river, which it can do. Like watching TV news can do too. I don't know, I used to be addicted to TV news. Any of you ever suffer with that? You just couldn't get enough of it. Even just, you know, CNN, when the 24-hour stations came, glory to God. Now I can never get any sleep. But no, it really can be. Politics can be an addiction. And all of it's the world. All of it's the world. And the scriptures say, you know, put not your trust in princes or in sons of men, in whom there is no what?
Salvation.
No salvation. No salvation. But we do our best. We do our best. So, but I think we do see cultural, moral, social erosion. But it's up to us to sort of figure out, can we do something, even in this life, that will maybe give people, maybe not change their minds, but give them pause to at least maybe be able to hear something from the gospel. If we just denounce everybody, throw everybody out, you know, demonize people, nobody's going to listen to us then. Nobody. That was the advantage the early Christians, the apostles, had, is that the people who were rejected by so many were the people they embraced. Jesus himself gave us the example. He embraced everybody, even the most untouchable. He embraced and loved and cared about. And when they felt that, as soon as they felt that, and then he would say to them, sin no more. No problem. Yeah.
So my godfather, he helped me with some questions about differences in people. And he said, you know, we're not to judge. And that basically... love is ultimate. He says you love that person you don't love what they do. And when he told me that, it kind of opened up my eyes and my heart.
Right.
And also made me see how I am so not adequate. So that kind of helps me.
Sure it does. Sure it does.
And I'll always remember that.